All right. Next group is Are We Represented?
Hi, I'm Laura, and I'm here today to talk about Are We Represented? So representative government and the idea of representative democracy has been a part of the United States since our founding almost 250 years ago. And the idea is that the people who govern barely reflect the people for which they govern. In other words, your elected officials are a strong or a good representation of your community. But how does this actually look? Well, right now it's not going so well in the US. This is several headlines showing where there are lots of disparities around the country at various levels. There are groups that are overrepresented, which are normally white men in government, and groups that are underrepresented, normally people of color and women. And again, this happens at all levels of government, particularly or also included local governments. There are some headlines about North Carolina disparities. And information about these disparities in representation is very sporadic. You'll see it in headlines, and every now and then there are websites like Reflective Democracy that'll put out reports. But otherwise, it's hard to know how representative is my local government of my community. So our solution is to create a site similar to a current site, Open Data Policing, which collects and visualizes this information to show how representative local governments are of their communities, as well as other stages of the electoral process, such as how many people are eligible to vote, how many people registered to vote, how many people actually vote, and who is running for office. And then aggregating this information by different demographics, such as gender and race, and also intersectionality. So black men, black women, white women, things like that. This solution, like Open Data Policing, would take all this information that's difficult to really access as an individual right now and put it together in easy and accessible format so that anyone could access it, also providing context to explain different phases of the electoral process and why things might look different, as well as usually connecting interested individuals to groups in their area who are working on these issues. With this tool, it would help highlight potential disparities in local governments and how well the elected officials are and elected bodies are representing their communities, as well as providing real data, hard facts on how that's happening in your community, and helping to start in conversations about inclusion and representativeness, as well as potentially a tool for investigative journalists to dig deeper into how representativeness might be correlated with other outcomes in your community. So why does this matter? Yes, it's nice to see people that look like you and look like your peers on elected bodies, but there are also studies that show that it's deeper than that. Women and people of color better advance initiatives for the groups that they represent. It also it goes down the chain of other people also feeling engaged in the community because they are representative on a government level. And it changes the way that people view their government and the way that they relate to their government. So our impact with a tool like this would be to help people to better understand who is eligible to vote in their community, who's actually voting, who's registered, who is running for office, and maybe helping to change some of those things. Here are some local examples. One school board member in Durham, when he was stepping down, encouraged the Durham Public Schools to bring on someone from the Latino community. Latino students made up 30% of Durham Public Schools, and they are still not represented on our school board. And I also recently found that a woman is running for Raleigh City Council. She, if elected, would be the first woman of color. So our business plan, the way that this could be monetized, there are clearly lots of interested groups. There are over 900 elected bodies in North Carolina alone. You consider all the elected bodies throughout the states and territories, and then 123 democracies in the world if they chose to also pursue these things. And potential clients could be nonprofits or groups that are also interested in increasing representativeness.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for thinking through this. It's really good. So you've answered one of my questions about the customer and the actions they would take. You mentioned monetizing it. Have you thought about a pricing plan, or is this more going to be about a data sharing, information sharing? How do you plan to sustain it?
Well, open data policing was adopted by the Southern Coalition for Justice.
Social Justice.
There's two S's, and I always get from so, that's a group that took over open data policing and keeps that funded. As I was searching for other things, there are lots of groups that give out grants and funding throughout the country. So I think it could depend on if people wanted to adopt it on a statewide level, people wanted to adopt it nationally. The Reflective Democracy was a really awesome group that just learned about and researched for this. So I think there could be a lot of groups that are interested. We don't have a specific price point for that yet. Because again, there are so many different ways of aggregating that information, the level of the local government body, things like that.
So it sounds like right now this is really a database project. Thinking about products that you can monetize, have you thought about types of products that this could turn into, other than maps and charts and things like that? Or is that ultimately the value that you're trying to see?
I mean, that's our phase one, because that's a lot. Even just like holding a mirror up to society and helping people to, this is the thing that I feel, but actually like providing data to that. Another phase that we've talked about within our team is trying to find a way to help align that to community outcomes. So obviously there are a lot of studies right now talking about how elected bodies might impact policing strategies and other kinds of policy outcomes. But I think that stuff should really be informed by other research before we put outcomes next to data like that. But I think that could be really powerful.
Have you looked at correlation analysis across different areas that don't necessarily run on the same mechanism? So not every state has the same type of government and the same type of election processes. So how would you manage that?
I mean, there'll still be local elected officials?
Yeah, there's still local elected officials, right. But like I compare like North Carolina to Virginia, where Virginia has a very different system for managing their government. How would you effectively mitigate that?
Again, this is just a tool to our local elected body. So as long as they have a group that is elected, so it's not looking at a specific person and how they're coming together saying that I want to be